Students, parents, and my dear viewers, welcome to the EduPath, the Journey of Success interview web series brought to you by Expert Group of Institution Alumni Association. The police force protects the public against crime, violence, and other harmful acts, and the ones who lead from the front are police officers. One such brave police officer is with me as a guest today. That is IPS officer, Ms. Nisha James. Welcome you to the show, ma'am.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nayak.
Yeah. I take this opportunity to introduce you to our viewers. Ms. Nisha James completed her BA honors and MA in English literature from Lady Shriram College for Women, Delhi University. She was selected into the 2013 batch of Indian Police Service in the Karnataka cadre. As Superintendent of Police, she has served in the Intelligence Department and as SP of Raichur and Udupi District. She has taken the lead in several initiatives related to women's issues. She has also served in the India Reserve Battalion, Munirabad, and also as commandant of 4th Battalion of KSRP Bengaluru. Currently, she is serving as the Deputy Commissioner of Police, Bengaluru City Police. We are honored to have you here, ma'am.
Thanks very much.
I feel that a girl child becoming a woman lay officer, here there is something where the childhood may be very different. Childhood makes a very important part of your life, your parents and your surrounding. We are just interested to know how a girl became a woman police officer. How was your childhood?
To speak of my childhood, I would like to mention that I don't have any background in the services as such. Neither my parents nor any other relatives were in the public service, except my mother, who was a nursing sister in a Delhi government hospital. So that was my only exposure to the government services. And it was never in my imagination to actually join the civil services also. Growing up, I never had that sort of notion. Mm-hmm. People in the services have that sort of idea from a very young age that they must become officers to serve the country and serve the, the nation as such in public service. But I never had those notions. I was always oriented towards private service only.
Okay.
So I put in 3 long years in the private sector. Mm. In my private service, I found myself feeling a little dissatisfied with the scope of work. Mm. Not feeling like I'm very much challenged, and I was not feeling like I'm contributing any great significant thing to the world as such. Mm. That is when these thoughts entered my mind that maybe public service is something that I should give a shot. And it was luckily the same time that the UPSC had a change in pattern, whereas the pattern was entirely oriented towards rote learning. Mm. In this year, 2011, they did this an aptitude paper called CSAT.
Okay.
Felt that made the exam a little bit more approachable to somebody like me, mm. poor memory. Mm-hmm. So the format, I had absolutely no hope of making it. So that gave me a little bit of a boost of confidence to actually give it a shot.
Okay.
Luckily, my parents were all very supportive throughout, mm-hmm. despite quit my job and being jobless for a year or so. They were very supportive of me. Mm-hmm. So I had no troubles at all in the UPSC journey as such.
Okay. Is that because you were in Delhi? You were more exposed, because even places I've seen in some places, for example, places like Mangalore, people hardly think about becoming like writing UPSC exam and all. They usually go for being Karnataka is a hub for engineering, medical. They usually, especially in Mangalore, they think about mostly about engineering and medical. So is it because you were in Delhi that it maybe influenced you to give UPSC exam?
I don't think it's anything particular to do with Delhi as such. I think okay. It's an urban versus rural sort of scenario.
Okay. Where
young children always, they'll be aspiring towards a position where they feel one could exercise some power. In rural sort of setup, the symbol of power would be the district magistrate, what we call DC.
Correct. Yeah.
Karnataka. Or it may be the MP of the district. So these are the public figures of importance that one sees around oneself in the more rural setup. Whereas the urban setup, I think these public figures are kind of very remote. They're not visible to the general public. They don't touch lives as such. Likely to come across maybe some low-level officer or a low-level government official rather than somebody in high office heading a district. So you are more likely to see industrialists or business people. And in the urban setup, that is more inspiring to the young generation rather than figures in public service. So I think that explains the difference. So in Delhi, like I explained earlier also, I never had any sort of idea of joining the civil service as such.
Okay.
My idea was always for private employment only. This was a change of heart that I had after 3 years of private service. Okay.
The one who wants to serve country, maybe there are different ways of serving. That is, these days we say that lots of NGOs are coming up like activists. Okay. And also maybe as a civil, as you say, taking the position of maybe IAS, IPS, or maybe going into politics. So how these three things are different and what is the importance of being in civil service and serving the country? How it is different from other two?
First of all, I would suggest to students that in my own personal belief is that one should not go by externals. So you should not think of what is more attractive or what is considered more desirable, whether it is a career in engineering or a career in medicine, or is it something in the NGO sector or in the public service. But the starting point should always be yourself. You should always try to connect with your own values and your own interests and what really inspires you to, get up in the morning and through the rigors of the day. So in and of itself, all are equally good. It's all about what catches your fancy. Because it's all about your life. You have only one life. So you should do what you like. That's my first opinion.
When you plan to write UPSC exam, what was in your mind? Like, because UPSC exam is same for maybe IAS, IRS and IPS. So because you said you never had any background, so it is one day you decided. So when you decided like that, what was there in your mind? Was this IPS is by choice or you got it?
As you must know, the Union Public Service Commission recruits through this exam, maybe 20 plus government services, among which IAS and IPS are two of the services. So as part of the process of application, one is required to fill a detailed application form in which we rank our preferences in all of these services. So my number one preference was the administrative service.
Okay.
Second, I had chosen foreign service, and third preference was police service.
Okay. So
it all depends on how you fare in the exam, your ranking in the exam, vis-a-vis your preferences and the preferences of other people. So I personally don't understand those calculations much myself. Third preference, for which I have no regrets. I quite have enjoyed my experience in the police department.
Okay. How did you prepare for UPSC? Well, how was your preparation? Anyway, students, before I get the answer from madam for this, I like to tell you that on your screen you can see the WhatsApp number, that is 8296490168. So any question to madam, okay, IPS officer Nisha James, if you want to ask her any question, send question to this number. Yes, ma'am. So how did you prepare for exam?
My preparation was actually very straightforward. Main question that one encounters while starting with the civil service preparation is whether to do it by oneself or whether to approach it through some sort of coached learning.
Yeah,
by attending a coaching institute. So since I had quit my job, I really didn't have the luxury of taking my time in achieving in the list. So I had decided to go for a tutored sort of preparation. So I had attended coaching at Vajpayee and Ravi Institute in Delhi. Luckily, I had only, so it was very convenient. And I had savings also from my private service, so I didn't have any finances. So through one entire year, I had taken coaching for both the preliminary exam and also the mains exam, the optional. I did not refer to much material outside of what was given to me by the institute. Just my reading of newspapers and maybe one or two additional books for Indian polity. That's all.
Okay.
So basically, it was just attending classes, trying to... the entire thing is that UPSC is a very general format exam. It is not a specialized exam where you have to do any sort of PhD in any subject. It's just about having breadth of awareness and breadth of understanding.
But ma'am, what we have seen is even sometimes the academically very, very brilliant children, they fail in UPSC exam. They do the attempts, but they just actually they were very good. So what is that? Why it is this exam is so special? Why it is not a cup of tea for some?
My guess would be that a person who is very academically oriented will have a very particular orientation. Say if he's a science student, one will be very oriented toward the sciences. If one is a commerce student, very oriented towards the business side of things. But this exam is a very general beast.
Okay.
Have knowledge of, little knowledge, not a lot of knowledge. Little knowledge. Everything. Basically, the key to success in the UPSC exam. And luckily for me, I had from a very young age exposure to developments around the country and around the world, because my family was very interested in research. So I grew up listening, I grew up reading the newspaper. So not something that I had to pick up very fast. So the whole, there were several years of preparation without actually being preparation.
Okay. So it is a continuous process, you mean to say?
It is a kind of. What I mean to say is that you are required to have a breadth of knowledge, not a great knowledge. You should just read very widely, read about all spheres of life, read about politics, read about economics. Just basically expose yourself to all disciplines in life. This exam is very general in nature. So there'll be a lot of questions. And from my understanding, I think questions, earlier there used to be choices in some of the questions. Now they've done away with choices also. So it means attempting maximum amount of questions in the paper. And you can do that only if you know more about a lot of things.
Okay. To pass UPSC examination, whether the communication skill is very important, public speaking and all, because what we see is these days in YouTube, lots of videos are going on of people of interview of UPSC exams and all. So really that one has to develop communication skill and public speaking?
I would say one has to have communication skills. If you look at the format of the exam, there is a written exam. There is a subjective element in the written exam. Then there is interview, where you have to meet with a panel of interviewers. So one must have written communication skills and spoken communication skills, but public speaking is a very different skill. Interview process does not require you to deliver a speech. It is just an interaction. It is a conversation that you have with the interview panel. So one need not, I personally did not feel the need to have a lot of preparation for that interaction. It is just a conversation. The most important thing for the interview is to have clarity of thought and calmness of mind. That is all you need to get through the interview process. And an exam, of course, is about your strength of your written communication skills. That itself also, time is of the essence. So one does not have time to elaborate very much. One has to make a point in the fewest number of words. So brevity is most important. But public speaking is not a skill that is required, in my opinion.
Madam, from many students have asked about optional subject, choosing a optional subject for UPSC exam. So they're asking like, ma'am, how to choose optional subject? And some other student is asking, is this ideal to take same subject what we had studied in degree, like engineering or medical, for the optional final? So they're asking how to choose it.
This is a very tricky question as far as UPSC preparation is concerned, because a lot of people have a lot of theories about what is an intelligent choice of subject as far as the exam is concerned. But I've never been very intelligent about these things. So my philosophy in life is just do what you like. So this is what I went with for the UPSC exam process also. I had done my postgraduate studies in English literature. So subjects was English literature. The other subject was public administration. I felt that will be a useful background of study. Job that we are hoping to get is also administrative in nature. So the reason I chose public administration, I did not have any great calculations in mind about why I should take this or why I should take that. And since the UPSC is a very arduous preparation process, it's better to do something that you will enjoy doing rather than something that will feel like drudgery to you. So that worked for me. But in the present setup, I think there is only one general, one optional paper. And in the future, I think the idea is actually to phase out that paper also, so that it will be a fair process where there will be common subjects for all. So going forward, most likely even this optional subject is likely to be taken out. But given the need is there, I would advise that you go with what you like.
Okay, if that is the advice for those who are preparing for UPSC exam, ma'am, what would be your piece of advice for the students who are now into first PUC or second PUC, and maybe they are thinking from their back of mind to appear for exam and basically to serve country as either IAS, IPS or IRS officer? So what do you have to say for them?
If you are thinking of getting into the service from a very young age, I think that is good, only that you have more time on your hands than was afforded to me in my case. But if you have the time, then of course, the most important thing is to build on your general knowledge. That comes from, you know, reading of newspapers, reading of magazines. Internet is such a big resource. You have so many news websites and journals online. Then there are YouTube. I mean, the avenues are endless to consume information intelligently. So one must exercise those options wisely, use your time, and read up all subjects that are part of the UPSC syllabus. The first point of, you know, the first point where you begin, of course, is the notification. The very first thing one must do is, if you're interested in the UPSC exam, is to read the notification for the UPSC examination. Which will give you a proper sense of what is the scope of the exam itself, what are the subjects that are involved, so that you can orient your, you know, news reading and your other general reading towards those subjects, so that you learn more and more about what is relevant for the exam.
Yeah, but they can appear only after they finish their basic degree, right?
Degree is the minimum qualification.
Minimum qualification. So only after that they can appear for the exam. So how many attempts they can have?
I'm not very up to date about the recent development.
Okay.
So you'll have to check up on that.
Okay.
My time was four attempts or five attempts or something.
Okay.
My second attempt. So yeah. I never find out.
My one student from Bangalore, Basavaraju, he's asking, ma'am, I'm academically good. I have good communication skills. I wanted to be a police officer to protect my country lawfully. We feel that usually hire of police officers are controlled by politicians. After studying so much, if I am just a puppet in minister's hand, then what is the use of joining police?
For this person, I would like to tell there is some concept known as free will. So it is your choice to be a puppet or not to be a puppet.
Okay. So you have an option.
You very much have an option. You are appointed by the President of India, and only the President of India can remove you. So you very much have all your options to do what you feel is right.
Okay. That's a wonderful answer. Ma'am, also, I feel that most of the students, when they are talking about, say, IAS or IPS officer, they feel that these are the very privileged positions. So you will have quarters, you have servants to work for, you have people to come back. So that is usually, there are students who have attraction of this also. So is it that this job is really privileged all the time?
There are certainly lots of privileges to this job. There's absolutely no denying that.
Mm.
In fact, a lot of times people tend to just compare the salary that one draws as a public servant versus the salary that one may draw as a private employee. Say if you're an engineer or a doctor, you may be earning much more than a civil servant would be earning. Mm. But there are some things that you cannot quantify. You cannot quantify the security, sense of security in your mind when you don't have to, be wondering whether you will have your job or not if the state of the economy is not very good. There's no quantifying the sense of security that you have when you have people at home who are trusted people, who are there with your family even when you're not there at home. So there are things that you cannot measure in terms of money.
Yeah.
Those are the intangible privileges that come with the public service.
Yeah.
It's absolutely not denying that it is a very privileged position. Yeah. But at the same time, people who are attracted by those privileges must realize there are a lot of demands also on you as a person.
Yeah.
Demands of your time. You may not have the luxury of spending a lot of time with your family. You may face a lot of stress in your life. So these are things that you must be ready to face. It's not all, a bed of roses. Mm. It's a lot of hard work.
Okay. Students are still asking many questions about exam. Maybe we'll move forward from the exam to the real life. So, ma'am, tell us something about your training for police. How it was different being a woman, okay? So is it different for male? How it is different? What kind of training you get? So tell us something about your training and your experience, your feel at that time, how difficult it was.
Training for the police is a very special experience, I would like to say. Because especially someone like me coming from my background, I had absolutely no background in the outdoors. I had absolutely no interest in any outdoor games or anything of that sort. It's complete whole body. And coming to the police training was like a rude shock because it's very much physically oriented. A lot of strenuous activities are there. You'll have PT in the morning. You have practice that you do, then there's games in the evening. So a lot of physical component is there to the entire training. Mm. Of course, apart from the theoretical inputs that you'll get about policing itself.
Mm.
So it's very important also because your physical fitness and sort of strength are required for the job in a way.
Mm.
That is the most important aspect of it. And it also that challenging yourself physically also gives one a sense of confidence that you will be able to face any sort of challenge challenge that you face in life. Okay. And that is the key learning that you get from a training in the police services.
Okay. Ma'am, other thing is like a common stereotype being a woman in the police officer, as a police officer, is something which it's not digestible for many. Because I've seen even when here when some lady, woman IAS officer, when they come, and media will definitely come to ask, I mean, wish them. And the first question what I heard is, how you are feeling as a woman DC? So that's the time I really felt, is this really relevant question? So you, even you must have faced such question, being a woman officer, how do you feel? Because that too, when you are taking it as a SP, they consider SP is, there can be a higher post in the district, but SP is considered to be always with the public. So you are facing the public directly. So what kind of stereotype thing you have faced, and whether it has troubled you emotionally?
No, I don't think it has ever troubled me emotionally. Mm. But question that you said came to your mind when you found other women officers being faced with this question, that is a very interesting observation. Because I think we have to look at it from two points of view. One is a point of view of the individual. Yeah. You as an individual would not feel anything very special at, being in your position and being a woman. Because maybe that's not something that you have experienced in your life earlier, any sort of differentiation. Good. That is true for me also. I'm not really brought up with any certain particular notion, being a girl child and having to be a certain way because I was a girl child. Mm. So as an individual, it may not make much difference to us. But other flip side of that is the perception of the outside world.
Correct.
The society is not presented with very many women figures of authority. That may be in the political sphere, it may be in the sphere of bureaucracy. So it is quite unusual for people to find women in places of power. This was my experience, very unique experience actually, in Udupi district, where I had reported, and at that time the DC was a woman, Hepzibah Rani.
Yeah, all four were, I think, coincidence or?
I believe it was coincidence, because I don't know what design anyone will have to have such a setup. The CEO was also Sindhu ma'am. Mm. And actually additional DC was also a lady, a public prosecutor was also a lady.
Yeah.
So we had a big bunch of women.
Yeah. On the other side, you may not believe what kind of comments will be there. People used to think that Udupi and Mangalore, it's such a very subtle, and people are so good that even women can serve this. The entire team can be women, so that because there is no crime. That's what people think.
Yeah, Udupi and the coast as such, crime is a very subtle sort of thing. It may not be very visible, but there is certainly background, which may not be very apparent to the public eye.
Yeah.
And the moment that we had reported was actually just ahead of the election. So it was certainly not time to be in the post in which you are placed.
Okay.
And I would hope that we conducted ourselves decently enough to not have any such comments be made, that it was anyway.
Okay.
The perception, that is the point. The public perception.
Yes, public perception.
Because they are not used to the sight.
Correct. So when we are
having more and more officers, women officers.
Correct. When we are talking about public perception, you will not believe, if you just Google it, lady IPS officer, you know what is the suggestion which comes first? The most beautiful 10 women officers in India. Okay, that has been most searched, maybe the keywords and all those things. So I just tried it with the men police officer. There is no such suggestion. So that means even at that level of post, when you take, people see that external beauty and they search for that. So my when I read that, I was thinking, what is this then? So even a police officer, when you put lady officer, if that kind of suggestion when it comes, that means our society is definitely perceiving it in a very different way. So under that circumstances, how you are actually managing the criminals, how the criminals, the perception of criminals towards a woman officer.
Dr. Nayak, I would like to compliment you on such a keen observation that you have made.
Thank you.
It's a very, very interesting sort of a question that you have posed. One can say that why this is the case is that, as you said, the results is actually by what is the popular search.
Yes. So
it shows us that in the popular mind, what is important for a woman is how she appears.
Correct.
Because in our entire life, I think when we're growing up, entire orientation is not grooming women to be maybe persons of substance. It is grooming women to be either a housewife or not to, denigrate, homemakers in any way. But the orientation is that the woman must be groomed to be an ideal wife.
Correct.
And one looks for a partner naturally. The number one criteria would be physical appearance.
Mm.
That itself becomes like the key feature by which women are valued. They are valued by a very clear indication of this would be any sort of cultural production. Let us say films, for example. Mm. So what we find in films also is that always the character of substance is not the character played by the woman. It is the man.
Mm. Correct.
Who is the protagonist of the movie. And even in male actors and comparing them to female actors, one finds the differentiation where male actors are able to function and be very successful in their career for a very long period of time. Whereas for women, there is supposedly a certain date of expiry where the moment they hit maybe 25 or 30, they are thought to be too old to even be cast in movies as, the lead actress. So that just shows you that women are only valued for how they look in our society. Not in our society, around the world, actually, that is the case.
Mm.
So, but the second part of the question was about how criminals would...
Criminals, yeah.
Mm. That is a very strange question, actually. I don't know what to say. To perceive us, because... Actually,
madam, how I think I'll tell you, because I've heard sometimes, like usually when they're SP and all, they hit also, when the criminal, if you have to make them speak, okay, maybe there's certain kind of punishments which are, so maybe for a criminal, more than that punishment that he is getting punished from a lady, also can be a mental torture.
Because, that's
very true. So that's why I want to say,
you are very right in that. See, the general power hierarchy between the genders is basically men definitely enjoy more power than women. So when a woman is in a position of authority vis-a-vis a man, certainly it has a sort of emasculating effect on the male. How can a woman be in a higher or a more authoritative position than the man? So certainly that is a correct observation. But in the sense, if you relate it to the scenario of the police, I will say that there is a gender neutral sort of approach that probably there will be between a criminal and a police officer, because the gap in power is so wide. Where the criminal actually, when in the custody of a police officer, is so helpless that I think this thought is difficult to even cross the mind, because one, the only thing one has in one's mind as a criminal is to be on the right side of the officer who is in front.
Mm.
So, very extreme circumstances, I don't think that my thought will be in their mind. But in not very extreme circumstances, what you observed is correct.
Okay. Ma'am, even uniform will make difference in the... Because when there is a uniform, because I heard once army officer, he was telling, like when we walk, nobody will recognize us. But when we are uniform, it's a different respect what we get. So is it that even that khaki what you're wearing, okay, during the, so that will also make difference, because for students usually there is a problem of wearing the uniform, and we always tell uniform is something which will make you feel that you belong to that organization and you own that, there is a ownership of that organization. So how do you feel that the uniform what you wear, that will also give you that power against that somebody who is in front of you, maybe a criminal?
The power basically is the power that we derive from the authority of the police, the, okay, the powers that are vested in us, mm-hmm, as representatives of the you know, authority of the state in a way, and we are a very visible symbol of the state.
Mm-hmm.
Because mm-hmm, at the same time, say a DC may enjoy more powers as the head of the district, administrative head of the district, mm-hmm, but the head of the police department in the district, being SP, being in uniform is always a more sort of visible sort of representative state power.
Mm.
So actually inspires respect, it inspires awe in the public mind. So certainly a uniform has that benefit.
Mm.
As far as the, you I think referred to a woman officer being in uniform.
Yeah.
So that also, if one tries to think deeper about the question, the uniform that one wears is also not a gender neutral uniform. It is the garment that we wear. It's the yeah, typical garment that is worn by a male. Mm. So it's a complicated question in that sense.
Okay. Yeah. That's true. In fact, I heard in one place, very eminent, very responsible person, but even then making a comment that we are so much supporting women for a girl child that even we have allowed them to wear our dress, that is pant and shirt. I was, even then it was like, what is this? How you call it as empowering when you are giving a right to wear men's dress? Because even the college uniform can be suit and this, that is, that's right, how we feel it as equalities. And I feel that it's not equality. Mm-hmm. If even when I'm wearing a sari, I need to get the same power when I wear that pant. So it should not have any effect on how I look.
You're very right.
So that's what I was feeling. As we are talking about...
I think sameness with equality.
Yeah.
Being same is not being equal.
Correct. Thank you, ma'am. And there's one student, as we're talking about women here, one student is asking, I don't know whether student or who, madam, you worked as a commandant of 4th Battalion of KSRP Bengaluru. My question is, in the current situation, number of women candidates joining is less. What is your opinion and how to motivate? So I don't know whether it is that... data is correct, but that's the question from the viewer.
Actually, we're finding more and more women coming forward to join the police services.
Okay.
And a positive development is that recently even reservation has been made in the recruitment itself. Mm. I believe it's 25% recruitment for women.
Mm.
Certainly, we'll see the numbers increasing, but overall, I think at a national level, the figure is probably 10 to 12% or something like that, and only very few states that are actually on the higher side of that percentage. I think maybe Delhi and Tamil Nadu are on the higher side. We are not so much in that category. So I think we have a lot, long way to go to have more women in our ranks. But at the same time, an organization also, we have to see and consider what is it that deters more women to come into the police, and how we can make our organization more approachable and more friendly towards women folk. That is something that we as a department need to think about and to act upon.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, there are certain arms of the police that still do not recruit women. For example, the armed reserve does not have women.
Mm-hmm.
The KSRP of late, which is a good development, they've had two women companies recruited in Belgaum and in Bangalore 4th Battalion, of which I was a commandant. Mm-hmm. So there is the women that has come in. KSISF also has women recruited, but still reserve does not have any women. So there's a lot of progress to be made, and a lot of work that needs to be done to make working in the police a comfortable proposition for women.
Okay. Ma'am, what I can request is maybe a police officer like you can come to our campus like every year, because we have around 1,200 to 300 girls. So maybe we can, because even our many alumni, they have joined police forces, but I hardly see any girls going into it. So that's why maybe we can start from, I welcome your department to every year come and give some motivational talk and also inspire them how important it is for the country to protect at least girls and the women from the crime. So we need more and more people. So definitely we welcome you to our campus every year, and please do that. Come and inspire them.
Thank you. I'll be very happy to come, because as you say, what you see is what you feel is possible in life. So the more young girls and women are able to see women in different fields coming forward and, you know, achieving higher positions, that will inspire them to work with that in their own lives. So I'd be happy to come.
Yeah. Ma'am, as women, we all face challenges in the society, different kind of, wherever we are, whichever place we work, there are different challenges as women. So you also, as what kind of challenges you have faced?
I've never been very concerned about another person's reaction to me. So in general working environment, I've never faced much of a problem. But I will say that in situations where you have to be on the field, where say there is some bandobast and there is a lot of crowd involved, one certainly does feel at a certain disadvantage being a woman, because you can't freely assert yourself physically in that context, because you have to think of your own safety as well.
Yeah,
that is the one constraint that I felt as a woman in our society. In fact, there was some incident in Delhi also, some strike in which actually an officer was also beaten up. So it's a serious issue that you have to pay close attention to your own personal safety.
Okay.
Sometimes when it's difficult when you have to weigh your personal safety against your professional calling. So so that is a difficult
balance. Yeah. As we are all celebrating now New Year, recently on New Year Eve, okay, when we want to enjoy, we are into party, we want to party, even if they say that there is a curfew, then after that, we somehow people will convince government that not to put curfew. Okay, if you just go on the road, you see that so many police everywhere patrolling, and including women officer at around maybe 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock. So how difficult for one, any police officer on ground, that too when they have to do these kind of night duties, because they need to balance their family also. So how difficult it is on ground?
I'd like to give the example of something a senior woman officer had once related, is that when she had applied for some sort of extended leave to be home with a child to help the child prepare for an exam, advised by her male superior that in his own career, he had never even bothered to know what exam his child was writing. So this lady officer in question had replied that, sir, I don't have the luxury of having a wife at home, which is actually the key difference, where there are a lot of challenges women have to bear, apart from challenges of the job itself, professional challenges. There are a lot of challenges, a lot of personal responsibilities on the home front that women have to bear responsibility for. So long as the domestic sphere is unequal, these challenges always remain. So that makes shifts especially difficult for women staff. So the question is a much larger question of having equal distribution of domestic labor, families.
Okay. When you go to higher and higher position, the number of working hours will become bigger and bigger. That's how usually they say, maybe people who work from the lower level people, if they are working from 9 to 5, maybe the person who is heading the CEO of the company or the chairman will work for maybe 16 hours. That is same in any, even if you go to bank and see, like once you are a manager, general manager and all, they will be there extended hours after 6 o'clock also. So definitely when you reach such a high position, very, very important that you spend lots of time. And I've seen that just 1 minute before the program, you are driving, you were on work, you are on duty. And in between, you found a place to sit. And now it's like neck to neck. Anybody in your place maybe would have canceled the program, but we are very happy that you are here. So what I want to know is work and life balance is very important for anybody. Okay, whether it is for a man or for a woman, there's no difference. But even then, in society, it's basically, I'm not talking about India, anywhere in the world, expectation from family, okay, towards a lady or towards a mother, okay, anyway, it is, if it's not, anyways, she's a lady at home. So that expectation is slightly higher when it in comparison with the men. So that's why, how do you or the people like you manage their work and life balance?
It is actually quite difficult to manage. And you don't even have a child. Even without a child, it is quite difficult to manage. One can just hope for a very understanding family. Actually, there's not much you can do.
There's one more question from Srivardhan. He's asking, who was your inspiration for your success? Maybe who he is or who was, I don't know. It's written who was your
inspiration. He or she, I never had any sort of inspiration as such.
Okay.
But I did have like, I can maybe mention Oprah Winfrey. Like I used to watch a lot of her shows.
Okay.
Growing up. She's a famous talk show host from the US. Her show tackle like all sorts of subjects. That also was very enlightening. So I would say she was one big influence, but not influence in the sense of wanting to emulate. Just I felt that she's a, you know, inspiring lady, that's all. But nobody in public life that I wanted to follow or emulate, nothing like that.
Okay. There's one more student is asking, dear madam, how do you deal with the stress or tension?
I think one should not take oneself too seriously. That is the best way to not have any stress. Have a light frame of mind. Whatever situation you're in, you should see the lighter side of it. That generally keeps you happy and stress-free.
Okay. And also about, like you get lots of transfers and you keep moving to somewhere. In fact, you being a Keralite and born in Delhi, you speak such wonderful Kannada. So my question is, how do you learn languages like this so fast? What is that?
The compulsion of the job, you don't really have a choice. If you don't learn the language, then you're unable to function because all your paperwork, all your interaction, it's all in the local native language. So if you don't know the language well, that will hamper your performance itself. So one has to actually learn the language. There is no two ways about it. But personally, I didn't find much of a challenge because Kannada, I feel, is a relatively easier language to learn. And I knew both Hindi as well as Malayalam. So there's a lot of similarities between these languages. So I found it quite easy to adapt, not a problem. Plus, the people of Karnataka are most welcoming. Even if you don't speak the language, they're most kind and obliging. So that is always makes it easier.
Okay. Shashwat HP, who is studying in second PUC, he is asking, how transparent is a UPSC selection? What do they actually judge in the interview?
Like I said in the very beginning, the interview is not an test of your knowledge as such. It is a test of your personality. Oftentimes, they say it is a personality test. So they're trying to judge how calm and collected you can be in a stressful sort of situation where the stakes are high. So all you need to do is just be calm. Even if you don't know the answer, you just very calmly reply that you don't know the answer. That's all. They'll nobody will think any less of you, because obviously you've made it to the interview stage by knowing enough that you can be there.
Okay.
So, not too much stress on that point.
So instead of, you say that like, instead of beating around the bush, knowing nothing and just try to pretend, better to say directly that you don't know.
Yes, correct. Because however much you will try to pretend, they will see through you. Point.
Yeah. Ma'am, there's one more question. What kind of attitude should a UPSC aspirant
The question was about transparency.
Yeah.
So about that one point, I would like to mention that it is, in my experience, a highly transparent process. I personally had no connections or no influence of any kind. And in my circle of friends and colleagues also, I have not heard of any untoward sort of incident connected with the experience. So it is...
And even though you are not having any kind of background from, see, you have gone through that process. So that means it is, you prepare for it, you give it honestly, then you will get into.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So the next question from the student is, what kind of attitude should the UPSC aspirant should develop to be successful in career, not in exam, to be successful in career?
I think like with any job, the very first thing one must have is an openness to learn.
Mm.
Now one is placed in a position that is as high a position as this is. Like apart from the 1 year that we spend as in charge of the subdivision, whether it is IAS or IPS, the next posting is actually head of a district only. No. So it is a responsible post that one finds oneself in at a very young age.
Mm.
And one can very easily come to believe that you know everything there is to know.
Mm.
In the sense that you try to impose your authority on people and you feel that they will think any less of you if you admit that there are certain things that you don't know.
Mm.
So it's first of all very important to be very open and open to learning.
Okay.
And learn from anybody.
Mm.
The more you learn, the better you will perform.
Okay.
And at the grassroots, we'll certainly have more knowledge, more understanding of the realities of the job than you can ever hope to have somebody parachuted to the top.
Mm.
Most important is to be very frank and open with your subordinates, to learn the most you can from them, to deal with them in a fair manner, and to never let your position go to your head.
Mm. Okay. Ma'am, Daksha, one engineering student, he's asking, tell us some real life challenging situation you have faced as SP or as DCP.
Probably I would say as SP Udupi, towards the end of my tenure only, there was a very challenging law and order situation, which was the bandobast that we had to do for the passing away of Pejavar Swamiji.
Mm.
A sudden event that had taken place, and had a overnight bandobast to be put in place.
Mm.
Number of people who were expected to visit him for the final viewing, as well as VIP visits. So overnight we had to put all arrangements in place, and since that was always a possibility, we were preparing much in advance to have those things in place as well. But it was, even with the prior preparation, it was a lot of physical effort, continuous work. Maybe two continuous days of not getting much sleep, just running around and getting everything in place. So that was the biggest challenge of all, but ultimately it was also the most satisfying experience to find that everything went off so smoothly that even if we had three or four times the crowd, I don't think we would have faced any challenge at all.
Wow.
So professionally that was very satisfying. And it was all with the cooperation of all our officers who were there, who were to work day and night for that bandobast. So that people in that moment of grief, there was never any trouble that we gave them. We tried out things the most smooth and easy for the people who are trying to pay their final respects.
Yeah.
So ultimately in the police, one should always think it is not a matter of controlling people in maintaining public order. Sometimes it is facilitating people. So that attitude is very important.
Okay, ma'am, as you are talking about Udupi, there is a message from Mr. Yogesh. He's saying that I'm Yogesh from Udupi Police. You are inspirational for all of us. Thank you for such guidance when you were here in Udupi. That was just the message he has sent to our WhatsApp number. Thank you, Yogesh. And ma'am, that is for you. Yeah. And one more viewer is asking, what are the factors you consider as work ethics?
Work ethics. I don't know. It doesn't strike as a very complicated question. You do what is right.
Mm.
Be true to what you believe is correct. I think that is ethics.
Okay. there's one more question from...
Be true to your own principles.
So what is right, do it in a right way. Maybe. So that's the thing. So what are the, somebody is asking, what are the unique challenges police force in a big city like Bangalore versus smaller cities? Unique challenges.
I think this question is a little difficult for me to answer because I'm presently working as a DCP administration. So I'm not in interface with the public as such. So the challenges, I think, would be easier to answer for somebody who is working with law and order or with traffic.
Mm. But
that the city is a very 24/7 sort of scenario. So it would be a very challenging sort of setup compared to district where there is more activity during daytime. Here, I think it's always happening. So one always has to be on one's toes. And okay. That very demanding sort of work situation. That is what I am. But I'm sure there's much more to it, which I am not in a position to answer.
How Corona has affected police?
I feel...
As work.
Certainly work has doubled, tripled, one can say, because one is doing not just the work of the police, one is doing a lot of additional work that is not part of the regular remit of the police. For example, there was the migrant labor crisis in which police had to do a lot of work to facilitate labor movement to their native states. And, enforcing the lockdown itself, extended periods, ensuring that people were not coming onto the streets. That's a huge challenge and much more than is there as the regular routine nature of work. So a lot of challenges, but I think a lot of positives also, because public opinion of police has improved tremendously post, I think, the COVID period. That is one positive for the department as such, because generally having like being a legacy basically of the British imperial power, always the police department is seen as a sort of negative presence. During Corona, with the tremendous work that our staff and officers have for the public, has won so much respect in their minds for the average police man and average police woman. So I think that is the part of the
world. Ma'am, like usually we say that decision making is a very important thing when you reach a little higher post. So in your life, any situation where you found it difficult to take any such situation where decision making was really tough for you?
Decision making is tough. I cannot think of it. Actually, any sort of situation where I've had any sort of dilemma as such, I'm normally kind of very clear about what is correct and what needs to be done. It's just a matter of dealing with the repercussions, I think.
Okay. Now, maybe I'll put it in this way. When there are two groups, conflict between two groups, and they come to police, and all these things are very natural and normal scenario in any police station. Okay, so when two groups, there is a conflict between two groups, I'm talking about the bigger, larger group, maybe mob, and they feel that each group will feel that they are right. Okay, and they expect police to behave in a certain way. They will come with the first only some kind of that police will support us or that. So under that kind of circumstances, how difficult or easy for you to manage such situation, and what do you do?
The best way to win the confidence of any like parties in a conflict is to be fair and to appear to be fair.
Okay.
So that is most important of all, because when one speaks the truth, when one speaks from a place of fairness, I don't think anyone can bear any grudge. However much they may be upset about, their side of the story may be not carrying as much weight. If you're confronting people with facts and confronting people with facts free of any sort of prejudice, I think any normal, sensible person will have to agree. So that is what we find, because this is something very commonly that we face, because we're actually mediating between two parties most of the time. The only thing to do is to be fair.
Yeah. Oh, ma'am, it's really such an inspiration to speak to you, with all hope that one day you will come to our campus and inspire our girls as well as boys, okay, to join the police force or to do anything they do in a very right way, in a lawful way. So with that expectation, on behalf of all the students, parents and viewers, I thank you for being here as our guest. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Naik. It's been a real pleasure. Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. So, dear viewers, on our next episode of EduPath, I have a guest who has earned his name as a music composer, one of the top music composers of Karnataka, who is none other than Mr. Guru Kiran. So, we will meet next Sunday, that is the 10th January. So till then, take care, be safe. Thank you so much.